Okay, so how many people work for product companies like Microsoft or Philips or IBM or whatever? How many people work for service providers like Tata or Infosys, good stuff like that? How many people here are coaches or mentors or, you know, working on your own? Coaches that are working on your own. Okay. How many people are other? How many people tired of raising your hand? Oh, not many. Okay. Oh, here's your phone. Thank you. Okay, so anyways, what I want to talk about today is the Disciplined Agile Enterprise. What does this actually look like in practice? So what's the story that I'm about to tell? Well, one of the things that I've noticed over the years, and I'm a tad guilty of this myself, is that Agile software teams are really good at building awesome race car engines. We're good at tweaking Agile. We're good at tweaking Agile software development. We got a lot of great ideas. We can, you know, keep the engine analogy going. We can, you know, get better fuel mileage. We can become more performant. We can speed things up. We're phenomenally good at this. So you got a bunch of really bright people optimizing software development. I think that's a very good thing, actually. But unfortunately, we take these awesome race car engines that we're building, these awesome Agile software development teams, and we put them in organizational tractors. We put them in these legacy organizations with legacy systems and legacy mindsets and legacy management and legacy governance. And we've got these, you know, awesome race car engines in these tractors, and that's a big surprise when we don't win the race. I have no idea why. You know, I don't think a tractor has ever won Formula One. I don't think everyone's even been entered, but anyways, certainly if one has been entered at some point in history, I don't think it won. Because what we really need are race cars. We need these IT department race cars that can support our enterprises, that can support our organizations. But that's just not enough either. We also need a team to run the race car. So I'm not a race car driver. So yes, I could go and buy a race car, I presume. I could somehow enter it in a race. And I would probably lose because, well, first of all, I'm not a very good race car driver, I have to presume. But also, I don't have a good supporting team. So we need an organization. So we need a great IT race car, but we also have to have that in an organization that can take advantage, that can use and work with the race car in order to win the race. So we need to look at the big picture. So this is what I'm going to talk about today. So I want to address three important questions. So first of all, what does it mean to scale, at least within enterprises? And then I'm going to look at scaling from two points of view. How do we scale tactically? So how do we help agile software development or solution delivery teams, I would like to say, scale to meet the needs of the situation they find themselves in? And also, how do we scale strategically? So how do we scale agile across the IT department? Because once again, if you know we have these great race car, if we have these great racing car engines, these great software development teams, but the rest of the IT department is a tractor, then it doesn't really matter what we're doing. Yes, we'll have a tractor with a really cool engine. So what? You know, I'm sure the farmers of the world go out drinking and they brag about the great engines they have in their tractors, but that doesn't really make news headlines because we want to win the race. Because these days, if you're not winning the race or if you're at least not competitive, then you're destined to go out of business. So anyways, what does it mean to scale agile? So first of all, like I said, I like to distinguish between two types of scaling. First of all, tactical, how do we scale agile teams? And then strategic, how do we scale to IT departments? So scaling isn't just about team size. Okay, now obviously, you know, team size is interesting. So we can scale agile all the way from teams of two people to teams of several hundreds of people. I've worked with teams of many hundreds of people delivering mission-critical software into the market, like single programs of 600-700 people delivering mission-critical software into the marketplace. There's not many teams out there like that, but they do in fact exist. The vast majority of teams are actually 10 people or less. Well, let's actually see. So many people here right now are working on a software development team of 10 people or less. How many people are working, maybe a third, half? How many people are working on a software development team between 10 and 20 people? 20 to 50. 50 or more. Oh, okay, pretty big. Not so bad. It's a little above average. Only about 2% of all software development teams are 50 or more people. But be that as it may, apparently you're above average. That's the way I'll spin that one. Okay, so another thing we have to be concerned about when we're scaling is geographic distribution. One of the great myths in the Agile world is that Agile teams are co-located. Now, this is obviously a very good thing. I'm a firm believer in co-location, but the minority of Agile teams are co-located. As soon as you have people working in cubes or working in their own offices, that's a form of geographic distribution, let alone if they're working in different buildings on the same campus or different buildings in the same city or different buildings across the planet. And the more and more geographically distributed you are, the greater the risk goes up and, you know, cost goes up and bad things start to happen to you. So a point that I want to make right about now is that teams in different situations will work in different ways. So a team of 5 people will work differently than a team of 20, than a team of 50, than a team of 500. A team that's co-located in a single room will work differently than a team that's in cubes, and will work differently than a team that's spread across multiple buildings. Different teams in different situations will do different things. Then we have organizational distribution. It's pretty straightforward when everybody on your team works for a single division of a single company. A little harder when you have multiple divisions involved, politics start to rear their ugly heads, it becomes a little more difficult to prioritize, stuff like that. A little harder yet if you're involved in a consortium of companies that are trying to build some sort of a shared environment. A little harder yet if you're offshoring or if you're outsourcing some of the work. So you've got one or more external companies that you're working with to get the job done. There's some sort of business contract in place. So once again, different teams in different situations will work in different ways. Then we have regulatory compliance. Some teams, roughly a third of Agile teams, work in regulatory compliance situations. That's just the reality. It's not a paradigm thing at all. If you're working in the healthcare industry, chances are you have to conform to healthcare regulations. I've worked with Agile teams in very highly regulated environments. And those highly regulated teams, work in a different way than the teams that don't face any regulation at all. Then we have domain complexity. Some teams get to address very simple problems. So for example, not to denigrate the conference, but the conference app, that's a reasonably simple problem to solve, right? Fairly straightforward. Building an air traffic control system, several orders of magnitude more complex than the conference app. I have to think that the air traffic control system team will work in a slightly more sophisticated manner than the conference app development team. It's got a full range on that one. And then finally, we have technical complexity. It's pretty easy to work in an environment where you're working with brand new technologies, you're building a silo system that doesn't have to interact with anything else, and it's greenfield, so you're building it from scratch. I've never been involved in something that trivial. It's a little more difficult when you've got to work with older technologies, when you've got to support multiple platforms, when you have to work with legacy systems, when you have to work with legacy data sources, when you have to fix legacy systems because for some strange reason you want to pay down technical debt, when you have to pay down technical debt in your database, also a little more sophisticated. So we have a wide range of technical complexity that we're dealing with as well, and we're going to work in different ways when we do that. So different teams face different scaling factors. Okay? And you could also very easily argue that we're missing some sort of a people or a cultural or skills-based scaling factor as well. Yes, I agree, maybe. So, but anyways, this is challenging enough. So any given team will be somewhere on these scales. Your team will face a different situation than your team, even though you work for the same company, and maybe developing reasonably similar things, but different teams in different situations, it is what it is. So one process size does not fit all. You need to be flexible. Choice is good. Well, I'll hammer on that a few times today. So an interesting question is this real? Are we actually seeing this in practice? So one of the things you might know about me, I'm one of those annoying people that send out surveys a lot, because I'm a firm believer in finding out what the heck is actually happening out there as opposed to what the gurus are telling us. Because usually what the gurus talk about and what's really happening can be very different sometimes. So in this case, It does, in fact, seem that that Agile teams are, in fact, facing these complexity factors. Sometimes we have Agile teams. So, for example, an interesting thing, when we ran this survey, and this is not something I expected, one of the interesting things that happens whenever you do research like this, you find things you don't expect. One of the things that was very interesting was that Agile teams are more likely to be taking on hard problems than non-Agile teams. So the organizations that are doing Agile, and particularly more interesting, the ones that are doing both traditional or non-Agile and Agile, are finding that Agile is much better at dealing with complexity than not-so-Agile ways of working. So they've learned to, I got a hard problem, better give that to my Agile team because they're more effective at dealing with at hard problems. This is not a good message for the traditional folks. What I also found was interesting, which I also didn't expect, was Agile teams, on average, tend to be a little more bigger than not-so-Agile teams. The good news is we're less likely to be geographically distributed. Now, some of that might be we're still sort of figuring out how to do geographic distribution. Now, some organizations have clearly figured out how to do Agile in a geographically distributed manner, but for the most part, because we work a little bit smarter in the Agile world, we tend to avoid geographic distribution when we can. We try to get people as close as possible. So that's a good thing. So anyways, we are in fact seeing people applying Agile at scale, and it is in fact working. I don't have all the stats with me here today, but just take my word for it. There's ample evidence that Agile does in fact work at scale. So if you still happen to be in an organization where people tell you, Agile is good for the simple, trivial things, but the real men, they do traditional, no, that's not true anymore. Agile works at scale. Now, having said that, just because other people have figured out how to scale Agile and make it work doesn't mean that you will figure out how to make it work. So, there's no guarantees in life on this one. The other issue, just to briefly talk about before we get into details a little bit later on, is we also need to think about how do we scale, how do we build this racing car, this IT racing car? So how do we scale Agile to the IT level? And so this is a very high-level flow diagram. We'll go into a little more detail in a bit. But the idea is how do we streamline the flow throughout the entire IT effort? Because all it takes, so it's great, once again, it gets back to the racing car engine. If we've got some Agile delivery teams or lean delivery teams, and they're doing a great job, but then suddenly they have to work with the data management crowd in order to get a change to the database, and it takes 6 weeks to add a column into a table. It takes 6 weeks to do 5 minutes worth of work. Well, that's a bit of a problem. And I work in organizations where that's the case. It takes 6 weeks to do reasonably straightforward things because of their onerous processes and all that sort of stuff. So if we don't streamline everything, and we don't find ways for these people to work together effectively, then it doesn't really matter all these cool things that the Agile teams are doing, because we're still going to get brought down by the one or two teams that are working in the old way. The other interesting thing about this is something that that's called the bimodal problem. So Gartner talks about organizations being bimodal. So you've got mode one teams that they call predictable, which I find insulting, but anyways, they're the traditional slow teams. Then you've got the mode two, the agile lean teams that are working fast and in a more disciplined, quality-focused manner. They can get stuff out the door quicker. And the idea is, or the observation, is that somewhere around 80 to 90% of organizations have both mode one and mode two going on. Because either they haven't fully transitioned to Agile yet, which I think is the case in the vast majority of them, or it does in fact make sense to have some mode one teams and some mode two teams. I argue that it's really multimodal. We'll talk about that in a few minutes. But be that as it may, there's at least two or more modes of working in the vast majority of enterprises out there, and we need to respect that. So if you're an enterprise architect and you are supposed to support development teams, which is the fundamental job of an enterprise architect, or at least one of the fundamental tasks they have to do, they have to be able to work with the traditional teams in a traditional manner and the agile teams in an agile manner and the lean teams in a lean manner and so on. Okay, so their jobs become more difficult. If you locally optimize on enterprise architecture, if you've got one way to do enterprise architecture, then you're not going to work well with at least one of those modes of teams. Okay? So that, I think, is an important thing. The other thing is, this is also, this diagram, and like I said, there's more to it than this, but this diagram is, think of this from the point of view of the CIO. So let's raise our view up. Let's get away from the selfish, you know, whatever our selfish points of view are, unless, of course, you're a CIO, and then this is your selfish point of view. But let's look at it, the point of view of a CIO. And as a CIO, if you're responsible for having an effective IT organization to support the rest of your company, you got to make all this stuff work. The challenge is that there's different bodies of knowledge for all of these things. So the development folks, the delivery or software development folks, they've got several bodies of knowledge. We've got the Agile canon. We've got the software engineering BOC, and two reasonably different things, and CMAT and all that good sort of stuff. The data folks have got DEMA. The management, the portfolio management folks, they've got the PMI and the PRINCE2 stuff. The enterprise architects, they got TOGAF and MODAF and DODAF and Zocman and five other things that I can't whip off the top of my head. The operations folks have ITIL. And they're all great bodies of knowledge. They're all wonderful. They all got some great ideas. They've all got some not so great ideas as well. It is what it is. They contradict each other. They don't fit together very well. They overlap. All of them are the center of the universe. Like, this conference is all about how we, Agile software people, are the center of the universe. We're the most important people on the planet. And if we were to go to an ITIL conference, well, the ITIL people are very obviously the most important people on the planet. And so on and so on and so on. So it's a complete dog's breakfast. And worse yet, so if you're the CIO, you've got to listen to all these people going, blah, 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 ITIL's the greatest thing since sliced bread, and we're the center of the universe. Blah, 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 Agile's the greatest thing since sliced bread, we're the center of the universe. Blah, 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 enterprise architecture, center of the universe, all that sort of stuff, right? What do you do? What do you do? So keep that in mind. So anyways, how do we scale Agile tactically? So an important observation. I'm a firm believer in empiricism, and as well as in constant improvement. So one of the beautiful things about empiricism is that there's a lot of, you can see a lot of great things happening out there. You can also see a lot of not so great things happening out there. So I'm a firm believer in asking questions around the lines of what, so any given practice or strategy, I'm always asking the question, in what situation does this work? What are the advantages? Why would I want to follow this practice, if at all? What are the disadvantages? What are the side effects that I might not, what are the negative side effects that I might not like about this practice? In what situation does this practice make sense? And in what situation or situations does this practice not make sense? I'm a firm believer, there's no such thing as best practices. That's a marketing term. Okay, whenever somebody talks about best practices, they're taking you for a ride. Okay, every given practice, every given strategy works well in some situations, and it's the kiss of death in others. So you got to be really smart, and you got to be got to observe and ask questions and try to figure out, does this practice work well for me? So you need choice, because you got to choose the right practices, the right strategies, the right team structures, the right cultural aspects for you. And you should always be striving to improve. One of the great things about Agile is that it made it clear that we should be reflecting on a regular basis. We should be actively striving as individuals and as teams to get better. So that's all good stuff. So anyways, the Discipline Agile framework came out of empiricism. It was based on the observations of myself and my team going around to organizations around the world, seeing how they were applying Agile in practice, seeing how they were applying Agile in these not so perfect situations. And many of you, when you're sticking up your hands, very clearly you're not working in such perfect situations. And chances are pretty good you're not empowered to change those situations drastically, at least not quickly. You got to learn to live with it and do the best you can in the situation you find yourself in, and then improve your way out of it, I hope, or improve your way into a better situation. So there's a bunch of great characteristics of DAD, exactly what you expect from Agile stuff. It's very people-oriented, learning-oriented. We try to get rid of some things that you might not expect. We try to get rid of all the prescription out there by being goal-driven or capability-driven. We'll walk through some of the implications of that in a few minutes. On the software development side of things, I'm a firm believer in looking at the full delivery lifecycle from beginning to end. And better yet, if you're a stable team, then it's just, from the beginning of that stable team until, infinity and beyond, to quote a good cartoon character. I'm a firm believer in being solution-focused, not just software-focused. I think the one of the things the Agile Manifesto did was cause some significant damage out there in developer land by being too overly focused on software development. We don't just build software. That's a misnomer. Our software runs on hardware. We often have to improve the hardware that we're working on, and even deploying to the cloud, that's a hardware upgrade in my mind, or a downgrade depending on your point of view. We often have to change the business structure. The business processes around the usage of these solutions. We often change the organizational structure of the people that are using these systems. We often have supporting documentation. So we have this full solution that we're working on, not just software. So we need to up our game, right? So in the 90s, the industry was on the right path, maturing in that respect. We sort of backslided when we started overly focusing on software. So anyways, room for improvement. And we're enterprise aware. I'll talk about what that is. That's based on the observation that my team is only one of many teams, and that we need to work with these other teams effectively. And those other teams need to work with my team effectively as well. And we need to do what's right for the company, not just what's convenient for my team. We need to look at the bigger picture, a little more robust. So Dad's a hybrid. So one of the great things about Agile is that there's hundreds, if not thousands, of practices out there. The problem is that there's hundreds, if not thousands, of practices out there. How do you find out about them? How do you know which ones to apply? How do you know to what extent to apply these practices, or to even to apply them at all? How do you choose intelligently? So that's an interesting thing I want you to think about for a few minutes. So anyways, like I said, it's pretty easy to observe that my team or your team is one of many teams in your company, unless you're a very small one-team company. So how do we make this work? So in Discipline Agile, we baked in this philosophy of enterprise awareness. And what it is, we observe, if you observe the history of software engineering, the traditional folks were all about individual awareness. I want to be the best tester I could be. I want to be the best programmer or the best architect I can be. I'm going to do my work, and then I'm going to throw it over the wall to the next person, and then they're going to do their work and throw it over the wall to the next person, and so on. More like a Tayloristic, very finely grained way of working. And that's theoretically interesting, but it's a phenomenally inefficient way of organizing a team. So the Agile folks came along and they observed, hey, teams of people build software. We really need to be team focused. We need to have these whole teams. We need to get out of their way, give them the resources they need, time and money and whatever it takes, and then get out of their way, let them, support them as much as we can, of course, but let them do their own thing. That was definitely a step in the right direction. But we really need these teams to be enterprise aware. If I'm a Bank of America, or if I'm a, some large insurance company, or Ford Motor Company, or Microsoft, or any of these reasonable sized organizations, I don't need you going off and creating yet another customer database. I just don't. Okay? If there's an existing customer database out there, please reuse it. Please follow common conventions. Please pay down technical debt when you run into it. Obviously, we'll have to fund it and find ways to fund all that sort of stuff. So we need to be a little more mature. Please follow a common technical roadmap. Please follow some sort of common business roadmap. Make sure that whatever you're building reflects the overall needs of the organization and whatever our overall direction is. So we don't want teams just going off willy-nilly, doing whatever they want. The fleet of teams needs to be sailing in pretty much the same direction for us to be effective as an organization. So we can up our game there. And this is important. This is a culture building thing. So earlier James was talking about the need to improve quality and pay down technical debt. Well, part of that is you got to bake it into your culture. So for example, if you go home tonight and say you're the only one at home and you walk into the kitchen, you want to make yourself dinner, and you walk into the kitchen and somebody has spilled orange juice. You didn't do it, but somebody in your family, probably your idiot teenage son. So the idiot teenage son spilled orange juice, right? It's the usual culprit for anything stupid that goes on in your household. So as an adult, what do? Yeah, you clean it up, right? Pardon me? You do your cooking first because you're hungry. Okay, that's strange. So most people clean first, right? You clean up the orange juice, There's nobody to complain to. You're the only one at home. So you can complain. So maybe you're bimodal. But anyways, you can complain to yourself all you want. Nobody's listening. Okay, so what do? You're an adult. You clean the orange juice up, right? This is what you do. Well, if you go back to work tomorrow and you open up a code file and there's a mess in the code, right? Poor quality, whatever the poor quality issue is. What do you do? The majority of you will probably leave it alone because you're under the gun. You gotta build whatever feature you gotta build. Somebody's yelling at you to, you know, be on time and be on schedule. Most people don't clean up the code. They haven't, you know, so you've somehow, you as an adult, you've baked into this idea that, oh, we need to clean up juice when we see it. But as a IT professional, as an IT adult, we still, you know, across the industry, we still haven't figured out, oh, we need to pay down technical debt when we run into it. And we have all these excuses for why it's not our fault. But it is what it is. So anyways, we need to start baking, in Discipline Agile, we want to start baking some of these cultural imperatives right into our organization. So following common conventions, working to common guidelines, working to a common vision, working together, paying down technical debt, not such a bad idea. Another important observation, now this is a snowflake, and I realize I'm in Bangalore, and it never actually snows here, but in Toronto, where I'm from, you know, it snows, you know, 365 days a year. That'll be the lie that I tell you about Toronto. That's not true at all. But anyway, snows in the winter. So snowflakes are unique. People are unique. If I look around this room, it's a room full of unique people. And even if there was, is there a set of twins in the room? Every so often that happens. No, there's no twins. Okay, even if there was a set of twins or triplets, if you know anybody who are identical twins, one of the big things that they do in life is they go out of the way to prove to you how they're not identical. Unless, of course, they're on TV and there's all shenanigans. But even twins are desperate to show you that they're unique. So every person, every team, and every organization is unique. This is a critical observation. We're in different situations, so we're going to work in different ways. Even two teams that are in basically the same situation will still work in unique ways because they're different people with different skills and different preferences, and they're going to work in different ways. This can be phenomenally frustrating in a large enterprise where there's people running around with this vision of, oh, we're going to have a repeatable process. Repeatable processes have nothing to do with efficiency. They have everything to do with bureaucracy and justifying bureaucracy. And they're a good marketing scheme for, you know, for those of you working at service providers. You can still sort of get away with, you know, using CMMI as a marketing scheme, although those days seem to be numbered. But anyways, we'll have to see how that plays out. So what's some of the implications here? Well, if everybody's unique and every team is unique, then one process size, one life cycle does not fit all. So when I go into organizations, and I do this around the world constantly, it's pretty easy for me to observe that, hey, there's some teams doing some sort of a scrummish type of a thing. It's almost always scrum butt or scrum and or, you know, whatever marketing terminology is being thrown around today. But there's some sort of a scrummish type of teams going on. Sometimes there's some sort of leanish, kanbanish things going on. Sometimes we see some sort of continuous, you know, some of the smarter teams or the more effective teams are doing some sort of a continuous delivery type of a thing. And every so often we'll see some sort of lean startup, you know, lean product startup type teams because they're doing a new product. And I see this even in insurance companies and in banks and in retail companies when they're, you know, very clearly not startup companies, and yet they've still got teams following a lean startup process or some sort of a lean startup type of a thing, or, you know, they should certainly be doing that. So anyway, so because it's easy to observe that different teams work in different ways, in Discipline Agile, we support multiple life cycles. Now this can be a mind-blowing thing. So if you're an IT governance person, well now you're, oh, and you could also have mode one teams going on, some traditional teams as well, which we don't cover, but you know, we accept the fact that they exist. So if you're an IT governance person, oh my God, all these teams are working different ways. They're not creating the same artifacts at the same point in time, in the same way, following the same templates, and oh no, my head explodes, right? So if I'm on one of these teams, like the data management team or the IT governance team or the enterprise architecture folks or whoever they are, and I've got to support multiple delivery teams, and these teams are working in different ways, then I need to be flexible enough to support multiple teams working different ways. And worse yet, even if they were all Agile teams, so let's say we're in the fantasy Nirvana land, and if we've got all Agile teams, they're all still working in different ways anyways. And even if I could wave my magic wand, so let's just beat this repeatable process idea to death. Say I could wave my magic wand and all these teams out there, you're all following the exact same process right now. Because I'm Harry Potter and I'm magical and I can do this. Doesn't matter, because in a month or two, because all these teams are agile, they should be improving their process as they go. They should be holding retrospectives or some sort of a reflection activity. They should be learning, they should be getting better. So a couple months from now, there'll be noticeable deviations in these teams because you'll be learning. 6 months, 12 months from now, there'll be significant deviations in the teams because you're different people in different situations with different preferences, different ways of working, and this is what you're naturally gonna do. This is the reality in enterprises. Might not be what you wanna hear, might not be comfortable, but this is the reality, this is observable reality. So let's make this work. Let's deal with reality. So keep that in mind. So let's go through some examples. So there's different ways, and this is clearly not all of the ways that we can manage changing requirements, but here's a few. We could do some sort of a Scrum product backlog type of a thing. We could extend it a bit with some unified process concepts and have different types of things on the stack and all that sort of stuff, but it's the same basic idea. We have a stack of requirements. We work down the stack. We could take some sort of a lean approach, you know, have some sort of a work item pool or a requirements pool, whatever you're gonna call that, where we're pulling things in one at a time. We've got different ways we can prioritize the work, all that good sort of stuff. We could do the evil formal change management approach. Now, all of these strategies have advantages, they have disadvantages, they can all be used in agile and lean situations. I have worked in a situation where formal change management in an agile team where it actually made sense. Now, those situations are few and far between. There are several orders of magnitude of people out there that think that formal change management is a good idea when in their situation when it really isn't. But we have to respect the fact that in some situations, it does in fact make sense to do formal change management. And what this situation was, I was working with a team and we were building the software for pacemakers. And when you're doing life-critical, FDA, anal retentive, regulatory stuff like that, if you don't want to go to jail, you do formal change management. Now, we also combined it with our product backlog to streamline things, but for some things, we had to do formal change management. That is the reality on the ground for some companies, and we need to respect that. If that's not your reality, then please don't do that. So in Discipline Agile, we're all about choice. So earlier James was telling us how these agile scaling frameworks are all about being safe or being comfortable or acceptable or whatever it is. And that's important. Because if it's not acceptable, it won't be accepted by most enterprises. That's the reality on the ground as well. But if you want to be agile, we also need to be bold or bald. I sort of like the bald one because all the incredibly sexy men out there are in fact bald. But anyways, I thought I would share it. Ladies, please pay attention. Don't let anybody tell you different. Yes, some men do in fact have full heads of hair. My 5-year-old daughter also has a full head of hair. Just figure that one out for yourselves. You can correlate, take any implication that you want about what's going on there. Back on track. Okay, so choice is good. So when we want to address changing stakeholder needs, when we recognize that different teams are in different situations and have different skill sets and different priorities and different preferences and all that sort of stuff, we need to give people choices. So one of the things that James was talking about is to be truly agile, we need to be bold or we need to be bald. Those two things are not mutually exclusive. Being acceptable and being bold or bald are not, particularly acceptability and baldness, are not mutually exclusive. Trust me on this. So anyways, what we can do is we can give people choices. So the way you read this chart is we've got this goal. So throughout construction, we want to address changing stakeholder needs somehow because the requirements are going to change and they're going to evolve and all that sort of stuff. When we do that, there's several issues that we need to consider. First, how are we going to manage our work items? So for example, which one of these techniques or others are we going to follow or combinations thereof? How do we prioritize work? Is it by business value? Is it by dependency? Is it by priority? Is it, or by many other techniques? When are we going to accept change? So if we have iterations, do we accept change? do we accept change in requirements in the middle of the iteration? Or like, you know, like most teams do, or do we push it off to a future iteration? Like we used to do, like Scrum used to prescribe up until I think the 2012 Scrum guide. How do we interact with stakeholders and teams? So one of the problems that James was talking about, which I fully agreed with, is product owners are certainly not a perfect solution. A hell of a lot better than what we used to do. It was a step in the right direction. Significantly better in writing documents and throwing them back and forth to each other, but certainly not ideal. So for example, when we look at this so with stakeholder interaction with the team, we have this list of choices, and it's not all choices. So one of the choices is for the team to work indirectly via proxies, a product owner being a proxy, a business analyst being a proxy, a product manager perhaps being a proxy. So we're not directly working, the developers themselves don't directly work with the stakeholders. A better way of working, which takes a little more discipline, a little more skill, is to have active stakeholder participation, to be side by side. You know, what XP used to call on-site customer, what we called agile stakeholder participation in agile modeling. And the basic idea was that you work side by side with your stakeholders. So that's what on-site customer is all about. We upped the game a bit in agile modeling. We said, hey, I got a live body there. So instead of just asking them questions and having conversations, which is a great idea, put them to work. The business people can actually do some development if you let them. They can be actively involved in modeling sessions. They can draw things on whiteboards. They can fill out index cards or post-it notes or whatever your tool of choice is. They can write code. These business stakeholders who apparently have no techie skills whatsoever, 5 minutes later, they'll be whipping out Microsoft Excel and writing some, you know, uber cool macro that might not be getting tested properly, but details. But they can, in fact, be involved in development if you allow them. And it's highly desirable to. And it's hard to do, and a lot of organizations struggle with this, but as James was saying, but it's clearly an option. So the acceptable strategies, which might allow Agile to get in the door, are this, you know, throw documentation around, which is a really bad idea. Maybe we can up the game a bit, get them in, you know, good business analysts or good product owners, but eventually we can evolve into active stakeholder participation, like Diana Larson talks about, like we were talking about agile modeling 15 years ago. Now, the way you read this chart is that, so we've got these goals, this process goal, we've got these issues or these factors that we need to consider, and then for each of these factors, we've got options. Now, we're not saying we've identified all possible options. That's not possible. But we are saying there's a pretty darn good range, and it's enough to wake you up, to let you know you've got choices. Now, in behind all this, every single one of these practices or strategies has advantages and disadvantages, so we want to help you make intelligent process decisions. So today, you might only have the skills or the cultural ability to work with product owners or business analysts. That's the best you can do right now today. Fair enough. There's better ways of working, so let's bolder ways of working that we can make you aware of, so that way you know you've got there's an opportunity for improvement here. So eventually, maybe in a retrospective, when you start to realize, hey, we need to get better at understanding requirements, it might tweak that, oh, hey, let's go look at, oh, hey, working side by side with the stakeholders, not such a bad idea. Let's try it out. Put him to work, even better. I can speed things up, get more hands. Not such a bad idea. Let's work through another example. So we can explore scope in initial ways. So at the beginning of a team, you know, at the beginning of a software effort, if it's a product team or a project team, we have to do some initial scoping effort. Got to figure out which direction we're going in, and we can do, you know, user stories on index cards or in some fancy tool. We could do whiteboard sketches. This is a UI flow model or a UI sketch type of a thing. And there's different types of, obviously, like many different types of sketches you could do. You could have one of those evil detailed big requirement up front documents. There are, in fact, a few situations, very, very, very few situations where that makes sense. But it's a valid technique, usually around keeping me out of jail type of a thing. Or we could go very high level, have goals. I've done multi-million dollar efforts where the requirements document was a list of 5 goals, 5 bullet points. Not even a sentence, okay? Definitely not a paragraph, and it was a multi-million dollar effort funded based on 5 bullet points. Now that was, you know, a really proven team with a proven track record, so they didn't really need, you know, detailed requirements. But the point is you got choices. And all of those strategies are applicable in some situations and not others. So do what's right for you. So the way we capture this in a goal diagram is like this. So we're exploring the initial scope. Well, what level of detail do we need to go to? And the point I want to make here is that you are implicitly making these decisions on a regular basis. You are implicitly making process-related decisions. So when you're approaching requirements, when you're doing requirements, however it is you do it on your teams, at some point in time, you implicitly thought, how much detail do we need to go into? What types of models do we have to create? How are we going to do user stories and epics? Are we going to do personas? Are we going to do UI prototypes? Are we going to do data models or class models, sequence diagrams? Whatever it is that makes sense for you. You had to make those decisions. You had to figure, how are we going to go about modeling? Are we going to have formal modeling sessions, do JADs from the 1970s? Are we going to have informal agile modeling sessions? All good strategies. How are we going to approach non-functional quality of service requirements? Because those things, the non-functionals, they will drive a lot of your testing effort. They'll drive a lot of your architecture decisions as well. They'll drive some of your functional requirement gathering. So we got to, we want to start thinking about those reasonably early in the effort. We got different ways we can fund teams. This will be a bit mind-blowing for the people working for service providers. But the way we read this chart, so one of our options is and once again, this is not all the options out there, we could do cost plus. So we have low time and materials with the occasional delivery bonus. In the extreme, this is just pure delivery bonus, and you get paid based on value. A slightly more risky way to work is a time and materials. So you just get paid a time and material rate. A slightly riskier way of funding an effort is stage gate funding. So we go to the well, we go to the financial people every couple months and please fund me for the next quarter, jump through whatever their hoops are. The riskiest way to fund an IT effort is fixed price. The worst possible way, unethical way for IT people to do. If you want, I'm not going to go into the details on that one, but please feel free to Google Ambler estimating unethical or Ambler fixed price unethical. We'll get you to a very interesting article on this subject. So the interesting thing about this slide, so we've got choices. These choices are all valid in some situations for Agile teams. They all have advantages and disadvantages. Do you know when to choose each one? The strategies towards the top are the least risky, but also require the most governance on the point of view of the business. Fixed price, pretty much gambling, but requires the least, just fire and forget and hope for the best type of thing. So anyways, we've got choices. So the way we capture that is in the secure funding goal. So I'm not going to go through all the goals, but just want to give you want to make you aware of these things. So in summary, at least to summarize this goal-driven approach, for delivery, we talk about 22 different goals. And these are all based on observations. And not every team does these things, so not every team chooses to do risk management, for example. Probably not a good choice, but that's okay. One of the things that James was talking about is would it be nice for Agile teams to pay down technical debt? Yeah, wouldn't it be nice? So not only do we bake it into the culture, or at least try to bake it into the culture, we also bake it into the process. Because there are ways that we can improve quality as we go. Hopefully avoid creating technical debt to begin with, that's another story. But if we do run into technical debt, it would really be nice if you pay it down, and there's a bunch of techniques to do that. So anyways, when we're scaling tactically, there's a lot of great ideas out there in the Agile community that we can leverage. But that's just a start. And there are some challenges. James and other speakers have been talking about this at this conference, that we need to go beyond Scrum, we need to go beyond some of these other techniques. But they do form a pretty good start. Discipline Agile puts it all together. It tries to answer questions like, how does this stuff fit together from beginning to end? How do we make choices? How do we accept whatever we have to do right now, but how can we inch our way up into better ways of working in the future? Okay, how do we become more bold? And then finally, and the idea is that if you don't know how to do Agile in reasonably straightforward situations, as a team, you're probably going to struggle at scale. So if I don't know how to do Agile on a small team, chances are pretty good I'm going to struggle if it's a large team. If I can't do Agile when I'm co-located, I'm probably not going to be able to figure out how to do it when I'm geographically distributed around the planet. You got to learn how to walk before you try to run. Okay, and I think a lot of organizations right now are really sort of struggling with this. They get good at Scrum, and then boom, they skip a step and they try to go up, and they try to start doing, you know, Agile at scale when they can't even do it at, they can't do Agile at small scale yet, at least not reasonably consistently, and yet somehow in fantasy land they think they can do Agile at large scale. Good luck with that. Now, one of the good things, one of the things we've observed over the years is that most of the scaling effort tends to fall down, or most of the process tailoring effort made by teams tends to fall on 4 of the 22 process goals. So how do you approach initial requirements? How do you approach initial architecture? How do you coordinate your activities between within your team and between other teams? And then how do you approach testing? That's what the blue thing is there. And I appreciate you probably can't read any of those. These slides are online if you want them. So that's scaling tactically. Now, how do we talk about scaling? How do we go about scaling Agile strategically? Well, it's the same sort of issue. We have choices. And hopefully we want to work in flexible manners. James was talking about feral architects roving around your company. I'm not so sure about the word feral. I've seen some feral dogs out on the street there. I'm not sure, so sure I'd want to pet them. But I certainly wouldn't have any problems going into somebody's house and petting their domestic dog that's, you know, part of the family and working together effectively, right? So anyways, so but this feral architect concept is baked right in as well. We can't see it on this diagram, so you just take my word for it. We're firm believers that the architecture owners on development team, on the delivery teams, should be actively working with the enterprise architect. It might even be one of the enterprise architects, depending on the way you choose to organize your team. And that pattern applies for more than just architecture, of course. So anyways, let's talk about it. So in Discipline Agile, we've been recently, in the last year or so, we've been extending it to address this IT issue, this racing car issue. So we've been adding what we call process blades to give people choices. Because the thing, once again, if your data group is off doing, you know, traditional data stuff, they're going to hose you up. Or if the enterprise architects are forcing you to go through some onerous, you know, architecture review process, it's going to hose you up. The entire organization needs to be working together. We need to have all these teams collaborating together in an effective manner, learning as we go. And these IT departments are what's called complex adaptive systems. So if we're truly agile or, you know, reasonably agile, we should be learning, we should be improving as we go. So my team will be changing the way that we work based on our learnings. Your team will change the way that it works based on your learnings. If we interact together, the changes that I make might have potentially changes to your team and vice versa. So we're constantly changing. And we're constantly learning together and evolving together, but we still need to keep this overall flow going, and hopefully speeding up, right, and getting better. Okay, so this is something that we got to keep. And we can't possibly do this if all of us are working from different playbooks. If we're all working from different bodies of knowledge that contradict each other and have, you know, greatly different philosophies. You know, an agile person, if you go off and read the DEMA, you know, the DEMA data management guide or book or BOC or whatever it's called, you will probably vomit in your mouth when you read that stuff. But it's the religion in the data world. And we have to work with them. Right? So we need to respect that. So how do you do it? So anyways, when it comes to program management, we've got choices. There's many different techniques. And once again, I'm not saying that we've identified all possible techniques and all possible combinations. But we give you a pretty darn good list, and it should certainly get you out of the prescriptive mindset and let you know that you've got options, some of which are significantly better than others sometimes. From a workflow point of view, this is what I call one of our selfish workflow diagrams, where from the program management point of view, so from that activity, how are they interacting with these other activities? What types of flows do we see between them? How do we optimize all these flows? So once again, because we're complex adaptive systems, whatever the people are that are addressing these other activities, they will have an effect on program management and vice versa. And we have ways to get information back and forth across these activities and ways to collaborate and interact with each other. We've got various patterns for how do you organize larger teams. In this case, this is one way to organize a program team. Oh, and an interesting point. We have, like I said, we have explicit architects. There's an architecture owner in each of these sub-teams, and they're part of the overall architecture team for the program, because you've got this architecture technical coordination to do. Yeah. At the enterprise architecture level, we've got choices, and we can leverage ideas from TOGAF and MODAF and all that sort of stuff. And once again, we've got flow. So I'll leave the scaling discussion, at least the strategic scaling discussion, with there's a little more to scaling Agile than a fancy poster. Okay? And yeah, we have a fancy poster too. Well, maybe not so fancy, but a semi-fancy poster. And there's more to scaling Agile than just that. I think we need to be a little more aware of that. We need skilled people working together who want to be successful as an organization. We want to make this, we want to win the race as an organization, because the organization is paying our salaries. And if we don't win the race, no pay, can't pay my mortgage, not such a good thing. So what's the story I told? So we've gotten very good at building racing car engines. And Agile delivery and lean delivery, very clearly important. Don't get me wrong. This is a good thing we've done. We've moved the ball forward. Very, very good thing. But that's a start. What we really need is an Agile or a lean IT department. We need a racing car, not just a racing car engine. But a racing car by itself isn't any good either. Right? It's going to sit in the driveway. It'll look cool. That's okay. But it's going to sit in the driveway and get nothing done. We really need a racing car with a team that can run it, take advantage of it, and actually win the race, win the business, take over the market, whatever it is that your organization is striving to do. Okay? So we need to look at the bigger picture, and we're going to be working at all three levels to improve at once. It's not just a change or a quick cutover type of thing. This is a multi-year, it's an infinite effort. We should always be improving. We should always be trying to get better. So we've got options. So in Discipline Agile, our goal is we want to help make these options clear to you. We want to let you know that you've got choices, that choice is good, and help you make intelligent choices in a streamlined, incredibly lightweight manner. Because software development is complex. IT is complex. One of the common things that we get from people is, wow, this is really complex. My brain is going to melt. Well, I would invite you to take a look at this and then ask, the question I always ask is, what would you take out? And the answer is, nothing, and you missed this, this, and this. Okay, so you want to make it more complex. Okay, fine. I can see that, but, we're trying to keep it as simple as possible. We are in a complex environment. It is what it is. This is why we get paid what we get paid. If software development was simple, we wouldn't get paid what we get paid. We just wouldn't, right? We wouldn't have as much fun either, I think. But anyways, be that as it may. So thank you very much. And I guess we got a couple minutes for questions. No, we're out of time. Okay. My work here is done. Okay, so anyways, thank you very much. I am available out in the hall. All you got to do is come up to me and talk to me. I'm also available via email too, so don't be shy. If you've got questions and you can't find me in the hall, then please drop me an email. Thank you very much.